This next section is all about retrieving data. And we're going to start with something called the GetTraceValue method of the trend object. We use that to get data from processbook. As you can see, here's some processbook data, and we can bring that data into a list box, as you see right here. Anyway, that's what we're going to demonstrate, and there's a lot of things that we need to learn in order to do that correctly. Well, let's go through the list. First of all, there's something called the trace count of a trend. That's the number of traces. There's an 8 maximum trace count, basically the number of pi tags on a particular trend. We have something called a current trace. That's the trace that we're currently dealing with. That's something that has to be set when you do things like trace values or get trace value. You need to specify which trace you're working with. Trace values count is the number of values in a particular trace. Get trace value again is our method for retrieving values. And then finally, we simply have some list boxes that we're using to store the results. We're going to look at the add item and the clear and the list index properties of the list box object. Let's look at the actual display in action. I'll go ahead and open this up. This was called GetTraceValue1. As you can see, there's a blank version of it here too, if you'd like to practice writing the code. I'll go ahead and launch this. I'll click on Get Data. And as you can see, what we're able to do is grab the data from this trend and stuff it over here. We've also got a couple of little tricks with the list boxes so that when we select one, it effectively selects both. Now, we could have done better in terms of what we put the data into. I like using list boxes because they're simple. We don't have to spend a lot of time explaining how to add things to the list boxes. Now, in this case, when we did this get data, there's a number of things going on that you may not have noticed that I'd like to explain. First of all, before I can do the get trace value, we need to set something called the current trace. Well, current trace would be a way to identify which of the up to 8 traces on this display we would like to retrieve data from. Let me show you an example. If I were to add another trace, this is now 2 traces. So the issue is, which one do I retrieve? Well, what I'm doing is I'm saying, let's get the trace count. The trace count is the number of traces. Trace count comes back as 2, so in this case it's going to come back and get the trace number 2, which is actually the one I just added. So when I click on this, you'll notice we get a completely different set of data than we got before. This is a completely different set of data, quite a bit higher than the sine wave was. And that's because, as I said, for my current trace, I'm using that the trace count. In this case, we're just using the highest trace to retrieve its values. Here's the code. I mentioned earlier that when you deal with a trend, you need to set something called the current trace. Well, the name of our trend is called TNDPlot1. That's the name of this object. TNDPlot1, as you can see from IntelliSense, it has an object called current trace. Current trace needs to be set before I can start making use of anything on that trace. So I'm going to set current trace equal to something called the trace count. Again, TNDPlot1 has a trace count, which is the number of traces on there. In this case, 1 if there's 1 trace, 2 if there's 2. In any event, it's just a simplistic way of saying I'm always going to get the highest trace. Now, in addition, there's something called trace values count. Again, we can use IntelliSense to look at it. Trace values count is the number of values in a trace. We need that because later on we will use that number in a for next loop. This for next loop is going to repeat as many times as there are values, each time doing a get trace value to get the current value. And we will repeat that once for each value in that trace values count. That's what returns an array of values for us. Let's take a look at the getTraceValue method. If I put my cursor on getTraceValue and press Control-I, that invokes IntelliSense and shows me the arguments, as well as the the arguments that we use with GetTraceValue. And as I scroll forward, you can see we need a value index. That's going to be a number between 1 and TraceValuesCount, basically identifying which value out of the dozens or hundreds of values we're interested in. So we're not going to be picking these values by timestamp. We're picking them by saying, give me the first one, and then the second one, and finally the nth one, the n being trace values count. So we pass that argument. We return the time that's coming back for the given requested value, and we also return the status. Was it good, bad, or what? Now it's the function itself, getTraceValue, that returns the value. So similar to getValue, it's the function itself that returns the value. So we're simply going to pass a variable from 1 to the point count each time retrieving a value, and I'm simply putting those values into this list box. There's two list boxes, a times list box and a data list box, that we're using along with formatting to populate to put the results in those list boxes. Perhaps this risks belaboring the obvious, but let's watch this execute. I'll go ahead and put in a breakpoint right there. We'll go ahead and switch over to the process book display. As you can see, now we're ready to go ahead and click on this, and we should invoke the debugger so that we can take a look at this as it executes. As you can see, my trace count is 2. I'm going to set my current trace equal to that trace count. That means that we're going to be looking at the second trace. That particular second trace, that current trace, has a trace values count of 231 values. Now we're going to be using that, as we assign that right there, we're going to be using that when we do our get trace value. Now I'll clear the list boxes. At this point we start our loop. Currently value is empty. The timestamp is empty. When I execute getTraceValue, as you can see, we have a value here, we have a timestamp here, return status should be 0, and that was for the first event. And we'll continue for the second event, and the third event, and the fourth and fifth event, eventually getting to point count. And that's what we use then to populate our list boxes. So at this point, I have 2 populated. And when I press F5 to continue, at that point it populates the rest of the list box. The values that are being shown by getTraceValue are actually the values that we were able to receive from the trace that were represented on the trace. Now this means if the trace had 30 pixels, like this example right here, you may have seen that there were not enough pixels to represent exactly how much data was really there. So for example, if we then go to something that had 300 pixels, that same set of data might have been better represented. In this case, we've got all 4 of these values represented by a single pixel. We can do up to 4 values with a single pixel. We do that with the first, the highest, the lowest, and the last value. But as you can see, if there were a fifth or sixth value in there, that might be lost. But it would not be lost in here because we have more pixels to work with. We can actually demonstrate that. If we take a look at our process book trend and I retrieve data, as you can see, I'm seeing a fair amount of data there. However, if I were to make this smaller, very, very small, so that, and then I'll refresh the trend so that we have barely any pixels to work with. I'll go ahead and revert the trend. Now if I get data, you notice it's a smaller set of numbers. And in fact, if I were to expand this now, you can see I've expanded, but I haven't refreshed this. So this is actually the values that we were able to see given the number of pixels we had. And this was this limited number. Now if I refresh my screen, as you can see, we flush this out. We have more numbers. Now that doesn't mean that you're going to get bad data. It just means that the data may be incomplete. It may not be all the values that were in the archive. For trending purposes, though, of course, it's completely accurate because you're not going to be missing any peaks and valleys in the trends.